Let's go live. Let's go live. Let's go live. Let's go live.
Ow. Ow. Happy Tuesday, guys. This is our Tuesday Takeover. It's where we cover a variety of pop culture news, reality TV news. We have a lot to unpack, so we're just going to get right on into it. All right, let's go, let's go, let's go, let's go. Hold on. Let me move this. Let's go. Do-do-do-do-do.
Won't you listen to me? I got that flavor. I know you're dying to feed. I ain't no dancer, just got some hip in my feet. Now throw your hands up. Ooh, you bring the lighter. I got the fuse. You make a fire. I'll add the fuel. Follow my lead. Just watch the shoes. Gotta turn the heat up to get this cool.
Welcome back to the Kempire channel, guys, your number one source for pop culture news and music, entertainment, reality TV, and so much more. Don't forget, you can also take us on the go by downloading our podcast, Kempire, on Apple Podcasts and on Spotify while you're there. Don't forget to give us a 5-star rating. And if you already are a subscriber, then you got the notification this morning that you got a chance to listen to our very first New York City show, Kempire After Dark, our sold out New York City show. So if you missed it and you didn't get to watch the video version, shout out to our members. If you're a senior royal, you can watch the video version right now. But you can still take us on the go and listen for those that may have missed out on the Kempire After Dark New York City show and you want a glimpse into what the Kempire After Dark experience is. Go take a listen. Go take a listen today when you get a chance. But this is our Tuesday Takeover where we talk about a variety of pop culture news, reality TV, and reality TV news. But you know, we always start our Tuesday Takeover with a little bit of good news. And I always want to hear from you guys. What is your good news? What is your good news today? What can you be grateful for? What has gotten you excited? What has inspired you? Let us know. Replay crew, I want to know what has inspired you as well. And what is your good news today? All right. My good news, I had a fantastic time in Washington, D.C. over the weekend. It was so much fun and seeing all of you guys in D.C. Yes. So amazing. We had a sold out show at the Union Stage in D.C. at the Wharf. The Wharf area is so beautiful. So beautiful. I can only imagine during the, you know, summer months, it's probably even more beautiful. But it was nice being down there, eating food. I went shopping while I was down there. I had a good time in D.C. I will definitely be back if you guys will have me. So shout out to everyone that came out from all different corners of the world in the DMV or outside of the DMV. Shout out to Baltimore. Oh, we're not getting into that today. We're not getting into that. But shout out to everyone that came out. Thank you to the host of What Else Is Going On podcast, Taria Faison, for hosting. And shout out to Lexi T for being our opening act from the DC area. We appreciate her as well. And also shout out to my fellow content creator, DJ Richie Sky, for coming out and showing love, along with Riley Knox. Riley, can't wait to see who you're dressing at the reunion for Real Housewives of Potomac. Can't wait to see it. You know, we've talked about Riley's designs before because she has designed not only for the Housewives, but also for Married to Medicine before. And we've loved her design. So excited to see that. Excited to see that. Shout out to everyone in the live chat. We appreciate you guys. Shout out to our King's Guard. Shout out to our channel members. And of course, shout out to our subscribers. And shout out to those of you that are watching in the bushes. Maybe you're not a subscriber and maybe you just watch every single Tuesday. Hey, I see you. No, I'm playing. I'm playing. I don't see you. It's fine. I'm probably the same person. I probably would not be, you know, all in the comments section or in the live chat. I just, you know, if I enjoy something, I'm just going to watch it. watch it from behind the scenes, which is okay. Which is okay. February is almost over, but it is still Black History Month. So happy Black History Month. All right. So that's part of the good news. Black history is American history. Just a reminder for those that didn't know that. Congratulations to the One Love movie, you know, the movie about Bob Marley's life. That was the number one movie in the country. Congratulations. I haven't seen it yet, though. I was away. Congratulations to the estate of Bob Marley. Rita, you've done a hell of a thing with that damn estate. She really has. The amount of thing, I'm so surprised that we are just getting a Bob Marley movie, but I'm sure Rita, you know, his wife, his widow, I should say at this point, she has really done the damn thing with this estate. So I'm sure she probably was waiting for the right situation, probably gathering the resources and who she wanted to work with in regards to making this movie. I've heard good things about it. Like I said, I have not seen it yet, but it is the number one movie in the country. Sidebar, speaking about number one movies, The Color Purple, you know, with starring Fantasia and Taraji P. Henson, that's now available on Max. I mean, I wish I could have seen it in the theater, but I got Vision Pro. So I have the experience like I'm in the theater watching it. It's cool. I'm going to do a video, y'all. I already did a video. I just have to edit and put it out. I have so much video content that I got to get to you guys. I apologize. Like, I'm only one person. But congratulations to One Love, the movie, Bob Marley's story in theaters right now. Yes, it's amazing. Beyonce is on the cover of Essence magazine. So Beyonce today, Beyonce's not paying me, y'all. She's not paying me. But at this point, Beyonce, where's my check? Beyonce's on the cover of Essence magazine this month. Where's the cover? I had it literally. This is the thing when I can't. Oh, here it is. Never mind. She's on the cover of Essence magazine this month. And of course, this is perfect timing because she's promoting not just her music, but also she has a new hair care line with her mom coming out called Sacred. It's spelled differently, but it's called Sacred. And it's out today. It's available today. I'm not sure if it's sold out at this point. You guys let me know in the comment section or the live chat. I don't know. Have you tried to get some Sacred today? It's supposed to come out today, February 20th, or at least you're able to order today. All right. So Beyonce looks great. There are so many beautiful photos from the, shout out to our fam over at Essence Magazine as well. I thought this was amazing, but it makes sense. Beyonce knows what she's doing. It makes sense. If you're going to do a hair care line for Black women or women of color, and you're going to talk about that experience, it makes sense for her to do a hair care line. Her mom has been in hair care before she was born. So it makes sense. A lot of people are saying, why now? How come this didn't come out a long time ago? Because to create anything like a hair care line or beauty brand, that takes time if you really want to do it right and not just be the face of it. So Beyonce's coming out with a hair care line, which should be available today. I haven't checked. Ooh, SC says no, too expensive. Ooh. But Beyonce's hair looks great in the cover. I think the cover photo looks amazing. But since we're talking about Beyonce, we didn't get a chance to talk about her nephew, a.k.a. Solange's son, a.k.a. Blue Ivy's cousin. All right. Juelz walked in New York Fashion Week last week. And everyone's like, wow, when did Juelz grow up? I don't know. I don't know when Juelz grew up. But he grew up to be a handsome man. Is he a man? Like, how old is Juelz? He's over 18, right? Yeah, so handsome man. All right. And mama, you know, Solange was at the front and center taking video and like a proud mama. Now Solange is also pictured in Harper's Bazaar this month. Solange looks, I mean, I know she had him when she was young, but still she is, you know, older now. Solange looks great. Solange, when are we getting some new music? I feel like Solange is doing like everything but music right now. I mean, like putting out an album. She's doing all these different things. But you remember, look, I haven't forgot some of the stories about Juelz. Juelz seemed like he was getting a little bit into a little trouble. I remember the Sky Jackson store. They're trying to get me, y'all. They're trying to get me. I can't even speak. They're trying to get me. Oh, I didn't get any water. Damn, I'm going to have to get some water, God. I cannot do Tuesday Takeover and not have water, okay? But yeah, so congratulations to Juelz. I don't know what this means. I don't know if he is pursuing, you know, modeling. Apparently, he has the height. Apparently, he has the look. Good for him. Congratulations, Juelz. Congratulations. Congratulations to us. Guys, if you are in the Philly area or surrounding areas, shout out to South Jersey. South Jersey, this is close. I'm not coming to Jersey anytime soon. Sorry. Oh, my goodness. I'm not coming to South Jersey anytime soon. This is the closest you're going to get me. All right? So Kempire After Dark, our live show, will be happening in Philly on March 7th. March 7th is right around the corner, y'all. It's less than 3 weeks away. We will be in Philadelphia at City Winery. Tickets are now available, and meet and greets are also available as well. I can't promise that I will be coming to Philly, you know, anytime soon. I know we will be coming back to D.C. at some point. No date yet. We will definitely be coming back to New York, my home city. It's easy for me to do New York. But Philly, if you want to see me, don't miss your opportunity. March 7th, all right? March 7th. Okay. So that's my good news. Congratulations to Beyonce. Congratulations to Juelz. And congratulations to you guys. Don't forget to share your good news in the comment section or in the live chat. All right? Ebony says, isn't Kempire from Jersey? No. No. I'm not saying that to, you know, be hateful, but no, I'm not from Jersey. I always find it interesting that you guys think where you think I'm from, but no, not from Jersey. Happy birthday, DV. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to anyone celebrating a birthday. Isn't it Pisces season? Shout out to all the Pisces. Shout out to all the Pisces, I guess. Anyways, before we get into any pop culture news, you know we love to mix this up and talk a little bit of reality television. Just because I just finished the latest episode of Below Deck, you know, last time we were live, I did not get a chance to talk to you about last week's episode of Below Deck. Look, a lot hasn't happened in these first three episodes, but I'm still a fan of Below Deck, and I'm such a fan of Frasier. I think Frasier is a great, he's no Kate Chastain, but he's not trying to be Kate Chastain. However, I feel like he has the sass and the personality for television. You know what I mean? So I enjoy Frasier. I think he's a good addition to this franchise. And his little things. Oh, when he told his story this week about how he came up in the yachting world, this is why I always watch Below Deck. Because you have to have a real skill set. You have to have a real history in order to be on this reality show. Yes, they try to do little pre-produced moments, but they have to. It's a reality show, but you can't pre-produce their experience. All right? Mickey says, happy birthday, Rihanna. Oh, happy birthday, Rihanna. I always forget you're a Pisces. I like Pisces women, though. Pisces men? Y'all questionable. But I like Pisces men. I like Pisces as a sign. They really love a Taurus, too. Just saying. But yeah, back to this. Happy birthday, Rihanna. If you see this, she likes the Housewives and stuff. You never know. Oh, happy heavenly birthday to the late, great Sydney Poitier. I love the fact that you guys even remember all of this. I love it. Back to Below Deck, though. So, Frasier, and the way he came up in, look at the elephant brains working. The way he came up in the yachting industry, and when people found out that he was gay and how they treated him, and one particular person on that crew that he ended up getting fired because he was just like, yeah, I'm going to work my way up and you're going to get out of here. And he was like, yes, got you out of here. I love that story. The other story that I love was Kat's story. Sidebar, there are way too many brunettes on this cast. And I know usually in the yachting industry, although it's not very black, it's mostly like blonde and, you know, white and things like that. I have to say this. Watching this cast of women, the only one I can remember right now is Barbie, only because she's a Virgo. And also her and Frasier got into it this week on Below Deck. And I like Kat because Kat sticks out to me. Because she's blonde. So, and everyone else on this crew in regards to the women are brunette, and I'm like, it's hard to keep up. I'm like, wait, which one is that? Which one did Ben hook up with? Sidebar, I don't like Ben. Ben's a good-looking guy. There's something about his energy that I do not like. There's something about him I just don't like. And I love the fact that Frasier called him out on trying to get the women fighting, spreading rumors and trying to cause conflict. And Frasier was like, no, don't do that. Do not get involved in interior stuff. Mind you, he's the lead deckhand. He shouldn't be doing that anyway. There's something about him I don't like. I don't know what it is, Ben. It's not personal. It's just based off your energy. It's something about, you're maybe a little too cocky. Like, you're a good-looking guy, but you're not that good-looking. Calm down. I think maybe amongst the men, is he the best looking? I don't know if he's the best looking. I already know the bosun's not going to survive. We already talked about this a couple of weeks ago. The bosun, he's a little, he doesn't know what he's doing. And Ben loves to call him out on when he doesn't know what he's doing. But there's just something about Ben's energy. I never really liked Ben before, but especially in this season, I don't know. There's something about him I just don't like. Sorry, Ben. Sorry, Ben. But not really. But not really. Guys, you're just joining us. We're talking about the latest episode of Below Deck. It's one of my favorite shows. One of my favorite shows. The chef is a problem. Anthony is a problem. Sidebar, when they go out and, you know, they don't play the music that the cast is actually dancing to, they're not playing that music. They are playing some copyright-free music for you guys. So it always looks awkward when they're dancing. All right. So... remember Barbie at the bottom, Barbara Pasquale? Apparently, she grew up very rich. So, you know, she's used to a certain lifestyle, all right? So I'm actually surprised that she's even doing this kind of work. But I like her personality because she's great for, you know, problems on the cast. Because she's already getting into it with Fraser, her boss, all right? Kyle Stilley, he is one of the deckhands. Only reason why I even remember Kyle now is because he told Barbie in this last episode, she says, you know, I'm a Virgo. He's like, I'm a Taurus. I was like, oh, a Taurus. But I told you, Tauruses aren't great reality television. I can't tell you a thing that Kyle has done in these first three episodes. That's it. We're not great reality television. We always tell you guys this. All right? But Kat's story. Can we talk about Ba? Kat Ba. So apparently Ba is not her real last name because she was adopted. Her mom died when she was little, then her dad died, or vice versa, I can't remember, but both her parents died, and when she was 13, she became an orphan, and she was separated from her brother. Her story was so dynamic. She grew up in like a cult religion from 13 to 18, and when she left that family, she reconnected with her brother because the family refused for her to be in connection with her brother. I was like, wait a minute. Between Frasier and Kat's story in this last episode of Below Deck, that's what kept me interested. I was like, oh, wait a minute. Her story was so interesting. And it explains why she's so insecure, because she grew up in a, you know, she spent 5 years with this family that wanted to paint this picture of perfection. And they apparently, according to her, were in a cult. I was like, oh, damn. I was like, all right. I'm rooting for Kat. I'm also rooting for Barbie because I know Virgos that watch the show think I don't like Virgos. No. I will tell you this about a Virgo. They're going to get the job done. Barbie is very competent in what she does. But I can also understand where you have a Chief Stew, who's the boss, and a Virgo who thinks that they know it all, Barbie. You're going to have conflict. And she's like to Frasier, you know, excuse my language if the kids are listening. She's like, you're treating me like a bitch. He's like, but you are a bitch to me. I took that very differently when I saw the snippet. I thought he meant like, you're my bitch. You know what I mean? But no, it was more so like, you're being a B towards me. Nandy, no. Some Tauruses, I would be good reality television. I'm playing it down. Look, I would be good reality television. All right? But we are also very, like, we Tauruses hold back. Nandy says, Black China was good reality TV with her baby daddy, Rob K, in my opinion. Yes, we can be good reality television. Don't get me wrong, but still. But still. I'm glad she's no longer on it, though. Sidebar, you do know the Wendy Williams documentary, the two-part documentary, is coming out very soon. In four days, it's coming out. Two parts. We're going to watch it. We're going to watch it, and we're going to talk about it. Philly? You're next up, so I'm going to talk all about it during our live show on March 7th, so get your tickets. look, get your tickets. Every single show for Kempire After Dark is very, very different because it depends on what's happening in that moment. And sometimes it depends on what we end up talking about when I get on stage. Sometimes I plan something and then we go a whole other direction, which I'm fine with. So I'll see you guys. If you miss our Kempire After Dark New York City show, you can now hear it, at least part of it, a good 45 minutes of it on the Kempire podcast. So be sure to subscribe to the Kempire podcast if you did it already, if you haven't already. All right. Is Kamora Lee is not a Taurus? Is she? Because I'm going to Google Smoogle that and confirm for me. Kamora Lee, if Kamora Lee is a Taurus, she was definitely great reality television. I just saw someone put up her her old, you know, promo for My Life in the, was it the Fab Lane or something like that? Oh, I used to love that reality show. Oh my gosh, I used to love it. I still love it. I could watch it right now. Anyways, but Below Deck. So they have new charter guests this episode, and these charter guests are all going to renew their vows. One's going to actually get married. I posted a tweet while I was watching this episode, and this is no shade to the current captain, but shade. I miss Captain Lee. Look, I miss Captain Lee. Anyone else? I miss Captain Lee. Look, our current captain, Captain Kerry, he's nice, okay, but Captain Lee's energy, he's just good reality television. Captain Kerry's all right. Oh, she's May 4th. Oh my God, is this why I love Kamora Lee? All right, Tauruses are good television. I was trying to play us down. I was trying to play it down, y'all. So y'all would stop asking if I would do reality television. Wow, Kamora Lee's a Taurus. I love her even more. Anyways. Damn it. Anyways, no, I miss Captain Lee. And I get it. Captain Lee has gotten, you know, he's had some health issues. So I understand why Bravo decided not to bring him back. You know, it's a you know, a legal liability. It's a situation that could cause issues for them during the season if he's not able to complete a season. I get it. I get it. Captain Lee's getting up there in age. Oh, but he's so good as a captain on this show. Captain Carey's okay. He's a decent captain, but he's no Captain Lee. Bring back Captain Lee. Bring back Captain Lee. Jack says, no, Captain Lee's grumpy. That's what makes Captain Lee perfect. That's what makes him perfect. Anyways, someone says, isn't Captain Lee sick? No, no, he was. Last season, he had some health issues, but he says he's fine now. But they didn't renew his contract. But he's still within the Bravo family. But I think because of they want to film a season and not have an issue like they did before with him, that's probably why they decided not to renew his contract. I still miss Captain Lee. I'm just saying, Captain, go back and watch those early seasons of, well, the majority of the seasons with Captain Lee, except last season, which was a little bit of Captain Lee and Captain Sandy. Captain Lee's just good. He's just good. It's good reality television. You can't make it up. Oh, Semhar says Captain Lee's a Scorpio. Explains a lot. Explains a lot. Just saying. I like Captain Lee. That's just me, though. Exactly. Candace says Captain Lee and his catchphrases. I mean, I feel like he started leaning into it too much towards the end, but I still enjoy Captain Lee. I liked his energy. I liked the way he ran his boat. I liked that people sort of feared him. I don't feel like this cast fears Captain Kerry at all. At all. I say all that to say, Below Deck, I'm still enjoying it. I'm still enjoying it. Are you guys watching it? How would you rate this week's episode of Below Deck? All right. Savannah says, Kempire, are you going to touch base on Love is Blind? Yes, we're going to talk about it today. We're going to talk a little bit. I did not get to watch the last episode. I did not get to watch the last episode. But I might do a special podcast episode. This is why. And it might not be a video version. So you better be subscribed. I might do a podcast episode after I watch episode 6. But we will talk about Love is Blind in general for our Tuesday takeover. All right, let me just say thank you. Thank you so much, MJ, for the super chat. We appreciate your support. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Nicolette, thank you so much for the super chat. Nicolette says, patiently awaiting a Northern California date. Napa, perhaps? Not Napa. Okay, what for the, is Toya coming? We're going to bring Toya? We are working on our West Coast states, guys. Stay tuned for that in regards to the Kempire After Dark live tour. All right. Let me move on. Let me move on. Hold on. Let me just see something. Okay. So we just talked about Below Deck. Let me just get into the other shows that I don't necessarily want to talk about anymore. I'm just so over 90 Day Fiancé. This week, we saw a bunch of people get married. We saw Jasmine and Gino get married, y'all. I'm going to say something nice. I thought it was a beautiful, simple wedding. I like where they got married. Jasmine is very emotional because her sister and mom and family cannot be there for her wedding. Do I still believe that this is not a real relationship? Yes, they are benefiting from this in a variety of different ways. I know I say it every single week, but I'm going to continue to say it because I believe it. Do I believe that these two are in love with each other, Jasmine and Gino? No. Look, no, I don't believe they're in love with each other at all. Right now, they're playing nice for the cameras, but look. So they officially are married. And I don't know why. I guess this is their way of trying to extend their contract with 90 Day Fiancé. So they tell the family at the wedding. I thought she was going to say, I'm pregnant. But she was like, no, we've decided that we're going to try and have a baby. 90 Day Fiancé producers, don't bring them back. I don't care about... This season of 90 Day Fiancé feels so pre-produced. And I know a lot of 90 Day Fiancé and TLC reality shows feel pre-produced. But 90 Day Fiancé used to be so good. All right? Oh, Semhar says Frasier is a Scorpio too on Below Deck. Huh. Look. Huh. That's interesting. That also explains his dating life. Just saying. Sorry, Scorpios. But it's true. Anyways. So back to 90 Day Fiancé. So Jasmine and Gino got married. All right. Clayton and Anali, we don't know if they're going to get married. We still, at the end of this episode, she has not shown up. She's a half hour late. She's on the fence on whether or not she wants to marry Clayton. All right. Again, the best part of their storyline was the fact that Clayton actually got to meet his best friend that he's only interacted with on like social media and online. You know what I mean? So I feel as if that's the best part. I don't even care. His best friend is there holding him down, being a support system for him. He gets really emotional talking about the brother that he lost this episode. And he's just like, you know, it's going to be all right. To me, I look at their scenes as the love affair. No homo. But you get what I'm saying? Like, to me, that's the best connection. I don't know if Anali really even cares about this guy. But I also feel like producers have decided we're going to cause conflict right before the wedding, but we already know that she's going to walk down the aisle. If she doesn't walk down the aisle, I would be completely surprised. That would be the most surprising part, is if she decides, I'm not going to go get married to him. I'm going to pack my bags and leave. Then I would be like, all right. Okay, 90 Day Fiancé, I see you, but I already know. They're creating all these little conflicts. Even the conflict with Sophie and Rob. Their conflict this week. Oh my gosh. Look, y'all know I never talk about anyone when it comes to their hair, but Sophie's hair is so distracting on this show. The first scene with Rob and Sophie in this episode of 90 Day Fiancé, and she's at the gym, and her tracks are showing. Like, the hair looks a mess. And look, Rob might not be the most mature or the nicest guy, but he's a good-looking guy. And I'm like, Rob, I'm like looking back at you. You find her attractive? Okay, her hair always looks a mess. Even when she combs her hair, All right, even when she combs her hair. For those that are watching on TikTok, whoever's a hater that came in and tried to report us, stop it. Look, stop it. Anyways, so Sophie's hair situation is very distracting. It's very distracting. In my opinion. Every time I see it, I'm just like, Jasmine says that she made a TikTok about her bad wig. Look. Lord. Anyways. Exactly. Trinity says, oh, not somebody trying to report it. You know, that's TikTok. TikTok, I appreciate you all being here. Keep tapping your screens. For those that are just joining us, this is our Tuesday Takeover, where we cover a variety of pop culture news and reality television. Right now, we're talking about 90 Day Fiancé. I can't believe we have another episode before we get to the reunion. I'm just so ready to get to the reunion this week. Nikki, based off the preview for next week, they're having such a great time in this last episode. Like, oh, she's leaving. She's so happy to be with him and the family. I already told you, I feel like this relationship, and I know I say this about all the relationships, but most of them I feel fake, all right? Based off the preview for next week, I don't even want to talk about what happens this week, because based off the preview for next week, their relationship falls apart. And I don't believe it. Even her crying and her reaction is giving very forced and fake. I believe they both wanted to be famous, and that is the reason why they came on this reality show. She wanted to perform a couple of weeks ago, and it's like, ew. It was terrible. He clearly has always wanted to be famous. I'm sure one of the ways, because she takes care of his lifestyle in Moldova. So she's paying for everything. This is another way she's getting this. And again, I know you're like, Kempire, it's not a lot of money. For some people, $20,000 for a season is a lot of money, which can turn into more money from sponsored ads and fame and things like that. So I never really believed this relationship, but there's not a lot that I have to say about it this week, about Nikki and Justin, a.k.a. Igor. All right. Sam and Citra. So they already had their Muslim wedding, and now they're having their American traditional wedding. However, Citra's father's like, I don't want a pastor because that will go against my religion. And this was like the first time that I looked at Sam, and Sam looked frustrated with the father. I was like, uh-oh, what's going to happen? What's going to happen? Again, another storyline that I don't really care about. Next week, they're going to talk more about him possibly going to jail. He's like, are you going to stick by me if I end up going to jail? And she looks like, I already got what I needed. But she still has to be in a relationship with him for a period of time so that she can get her residence card and things like that. All right. So who else did it? Oh, back to Rob and Sophie, though. Rob and Sophie, you know, Rob has had some issues with her mom. And so the mom, again, it feels very produced, because why would the mom, you got into a fight with Rob, why would you go stay with him? You don't like his place. You say that his place is too small. You can clearly afford to stay another night at a hotel, but she's going to come stay with you guys on a blow up mattress. The mom? Really? And they get into it when she comes over. And then eventually she's like, you know, sometimes I get hot and bothered when I'm insecure about stuff. And all of a sudden, all is well and good. I'm like, okay, whatever. Whatever. This is not believable at all. That's why I'm sort of just at this point, just wrap up the season, y'all. Just wrap up the season of 90 Day Fiancé. I don't care about, there's not one couple on this cast that I'm really invested in or even care about. Not even Ashley the Witch. She didn't even get married yet. Look. She didn't even get married yet. Anyways, I say all that to say 90 Day Fiancé sucks this season. It sucks this season. But since we're talking about 90 Day Fiancé, let's talk about 90 Day The Single Life. Another season that I don't care about. Another season that I don't care about. Natalie is so insufferable. I honestly don't believe that Natalie will ever be in, she'll be in a relationship, but I don't think she'll be in a happy relationship ever. She acts like a spoiled brat. She's damn near 40, if not 40 and over. She swears that she wants to have this big acting career, but you sold everything. You don't really have a pot to piss in, as they would say. You're going to, next week, she's going to, because I guess she needs a storyline. She's going to the fertility doctor to freeze her eggs with her mom and things like that. I like her mom. This week, she got into a fight with Josh, and now she's ended things with Josh. I feel like she ends things with Josh. Ever since she's been on 90 Day The Single Life, she's always ending things with Josh, and then all of a sudden, Josh is back. So please me if I don't, you know, believe that it's truly over with Josh. But next week, Natalie is going to the fertility doctor. Natalie, you barely could afford your apartment. You just moved from Florida. You telling me that you can afford going to a fertility doctor in California? Girl, I was born at night, not last night, okay? Ridiculous. Ridiculous. Julie, thank you so much for the super chat. Julie says, is it true that Jasmine and Gino separated? I would not be surprised. I would not be surprised because it wasn't a real relationship. I think they were trying to bamboozle the government, like, you know, Simon Gobadia, to stay here in the country. Julie, thank you for another super chat. Julie says, please make Natalie and Chantel go away into therapy. Chantel, look, I think the producers played this wrong. I get it. You wanted to bring Chantel. You needed a spot to fill on 90 Days of Single Life. But why are we trying to make it seem like Chantel really wants to be in a serious relationship with another man abroad and that she might possibly... I can probably see myself living in Greece. No, you can't. No, you can't. She's so ridiculous. And maybe if she went to Spain, because you know she does know Spanish and things like that. No. And her friends are just as ridiculous. This is why you got to be mindful of the company you keep. So she's really trying to play this whole, she's serious about this guy that she just met. That she just met in Greece. And look, I'm not saying that you can't get serious or fall in love while abroad and have this whole love affair. But we know, we could tell it feels so forced and fake. And she's upset that he's not giving her enough attention. Girl, he just met you. Like, it's giving... I told you last week, I feel like I might not talk about 90 Day Fiancé anymore. Just because of how ridiculous these storylines have become. Just how ridiculous these stories have become. And especially when Traitors is so good and Love is Blind is so good. Oh, no. Oh, my gosh. Let me tell you something about Veronica. I don't like Tim. I don't like Jamal. Ew. I don't like them. I like Veronica. Veronica might be, besides Tariq, Veronica might be one of my favorites on this show. Do I believe her relationship with Jamal is going to work out? No. Do I think her relationship with Tim is unhealthy and is probably going to block her from future relationships? Yes. However, I still like her more than Jamal or Tim. Ew. I really do enjoy her. Do I think that Jamal had some points in regards to you can't relate me talking to my mom and me telling my mom about us to you and Tim? And she's like, yes, I can. Tim's like family to me, but he's like, he's not. I get where Jamal is coming from. It is a little bit different. However, Jamal also, there's something about Jamal besides the ew. Besides that, but besides that, there's just something so annoying about his personality. He gives off, and I get it, he's a lot younger than Veronica, but he's not a baby either. He's like mid-20s, right? So he's an adult. The way he speaks, I'm just like, his voice is annoying. His personality is annoying. And you know, we love Kimberly. Honestly, this season would be saved if they brought Kimberly on. You think Kimberly's going to make an appearance? I'd like, bring Kimberly on. Kimberly. Just saying. Bring her on. But Jamal is insufferable. I feel like he's not mature enough for a relationship with Veronica. I do think Veronica has, you know, her own maturity issues. But I still like Veronica more than anybody on this cast. All right? And someone just said Jamal is thirsty. He is thirsty. I told you I got a glimpse of that. I don't know if it was this season or something else. I think it was when they were on the People's Couch on Pillow Talk. And I was just like, something about him is giving, I want to be on television. I want to make this on television. And it's not his foundation. Oh, ew. And nothing wrong with foundation. I'm just saying. It's just all gathering. All right. Guys, if you haven't already, be sure to like the video. This is our Tuesday takeover. We're talking about 90 Day, the Single Life. Okay. All right. Anyways, was there anyone else on this cast that I wanted to talk about? We talked about Chantel. I didn't talk about John. You know, every single week I skip over John's storyline. John, I don't think that you're ready for a real relationship. I don't. His girlfriend that he's dating who has a kid... they all have a double date with his brother, who we were first familiar with, and Thais. And they're like, yeah, John's not looking to have kids. He's not looking for, you know, any of that. So she's a little hurt by all of that. So their relationship is in turmoil because she's like, oh, so you're not ready for this. Yeah. I don't care about John. I'm sorry. I like John on 90 Day Fiancé when he was with his brother. I like him on Pillow Talk. But his own personal storyline on 90 Days of Single Life, I could care less. I am not invested at all. That's why I skip over it every single week. Sorry. Not sorry. All right. Was there anyone else that I want to talk about? No. But since we're talking about 90 Day Fiancé, we got to talk about Simon Gobadia. Simon Gobadia. Hold on, y'all. Let me see if I can. Do I have a good picture of Simon? Look, if that even exists. Oh, Simon Gobadia. We're not going to go through the nitty-gritty details of what he's facing. I just wanted to mention it because this is where we talk about the things that we don't get a chance to talk about. And if you haven't already, go listen to the updated podcast version of our story coverage of the Porsha Peach Juice Williams Gobadia story. So, as you know, last week we told you that Porsha revealed that she was going to be coming back to the Real Housewives of Atlanta for season 16. When I first heard the story from some sources, I said, I feel like she's going to come back because she wants to leave Simon. And I know some people say, oh, you know, on social media, they're so happy. But that's on social media. You guys don't know the real nitty gritty of this relationship. All right. And I'm not saying that they aren't happy. And you already know the full story behind how Porsha got with this man and how he was married and how we were introduced to this man. All right. So Porsha announced that she's coming back. She has this big deal with NBC Universal, along with a scripted, you know, first look deal with Universal, allegedly. Not allegedly, it came out and announced it. All right? So that was announced only for court documents to reveal that Simon Gobadia has a very sordid criminal past of ID fraud, of credit card fraud, of being kicked out of the country, of using the SAW program in order to secure his residency. So he's applied for U.S. citizenship. He was denied. Then he responded to that denial, and it was dismissed. It was dismissed. So an immigration lawyer on social media said that, I mean, he could face deportation proceedings. Doesn't mean that he's going to be deported, but he could face it. And he filed some of these documents literally like a month after he got married to Porsha. It made me wonder if he explored the idea of marrying Porsha in order to get the K-1 visa. Or maybe that's the next thing. I just don't imagine it. Because look how long Michael from 90 Day Fiancé has been waiting to come from Nigeria to meet Angela. I heard that he's actually here now. But it took years. But Simon has been in this country for years. A lot of these allegations of credit card fraud and bank fraud stem back to the early 80s. And I know some people say, well, that's 30 years ago. He's a different man now. Not really. I mean, there might not be any credit card fraud or ID fraud of late. However, a lot of people have said some of his shaking, you know, moving and shaking and dealings here in the States and abroad are not up and up, allegedly. I can't confirm or deny, but was I completely surprised that his past was sordid? No, I'm not. And here's the thing. We still do not know what Simon does for a living. Can you tell me what Simon does for a living? A clear answer, please. What does Simon do for a living? And look, there have been allegations, even from his ex-wife, Fallon Gobadia, now Pina, where she was just like, his office setting, where he like had a printer and nothing else in the office. So for me, Porsha coming back, I don't believe this is for a storyline. I believe someone dug this up, and because Porsha is back in the spotlight, dug this up. I don't believe that's the storyline she was going for. I think Porsha is returning because Alex called in yesterday and allegedly, I don't know this for a fact, is saying that once he was on Housewives, it opened up more deals for him in Africa, specifically Nigeria. So I speculated yesterday when Alex called in and I said, do you think that's part of the reason why he wants to come back again? Did he talk Porsha into coming back so that he can elevate whatever he's doing over there? Maybe. But I also speculated, I said, is Porsha only coming back because she sees the writing on the wall and she wants to get the hell up out of there? I don't know. I guess we'll have to wait and see once once they figure out this whole cast for Real Housewives of Atlanta. But these sordid details, when we did a whole video, guys, breaking down some of what played out in regards to Simon Gobadia's history. Danny says, is Simon even his real name? I don't know. Because what also came out in those court documents, because some of you want to say, oh, it's the blogs talking, making this up. No, it's court documents, people. It's actual court documents that outline why the government denied his U.S. citizenship request. And they said that they were not going to use his SAW program in order to verify that he could be, you know, become a U.S. citizen, because they were saying that was acquired with a fake identity. That's what they said. So that's why when people say that was in his past, well, that was in his past. But in 2020, he's trying to use a misrepresentation of himself in order to get U.S. citizenship. So is it that far in his past? You get what I'm saying? Because if you are on the up and up, wouldn't you just do what you need to do? You know what you did back then. You know what I mean? You know what you did back then. So why would you use the SAW program that you used allegedly? I don't want to say alleged because it's in court documents. This is what the government has based their decision on, not approving his U.S. citizenship request. So, I mean, what can I say at this point? I can only wish the best for PJ, for Porsha's daughter. That's the only person I can wish the best for. Because Porsha, okay, girl. Okay. I don't think anyone has ever understood Porsha's relationship with Simon and how that came together. Some people speculated that, you know, they were cheating while he was still married. I don't know, because Fallon has not come out clean in that whole situation either. All right. I don't know about that. But I also told you I didn't believe that relationship. I told you go rewind the tape. I told you even if they were having the in and the out in front of me, I would not believe this relationship. We watched Porsha's Family of Lies. And we still were not convinced about this relationship. I still feel like it was a scheme that Simon set up to come to us with the BS. DV says Simon has always given creep vibes. Yeah. And watching him on Porsha's Family of Lies, I was like, damn, it's weird. And I'm so glad they didn't give us a lot of Simon during that. And I hope we don't get a lot of Simon during this new season of Sweet 16 of Real Housewives of Atlanta. I hope not. Anyways. Deborah, thank you so much for the super chat. Deborah says, 90 Day Fiancé, I need to add this to the soundboard. You can leave. Thank you, Deborah, for the super chat. We appreciate you. Julie, thank you for another super chat. Julie says, putting you on the spot, but if Traitors had only podcaster CC, content creators and famous people, who would you want on your cast? Kate will be a great traitor. Oh, that's a good question, Julie. If it had podcaster or content creators, oh my God, I don't know. I would have to really sit. You guys ask these questions. Even during our DC show, you guys are asking me questions like that. I don't really think about these things till you ask. And then I'm like, I'm caught on the spot. I'm like, I always believe that there should be some sort of content creator, influencer, reality show. I'm not doing it though. Please understand. I would not be on it. But I'd watch it. Look, I'd watch it. And please understand, a lot of these, you know, podcasters, influencers, content creators, some of them are thirsty enough to say, yeah, I'll do it. Look, I'll do it. And we hope that you will. Look, we hope that you will. I definitely think Kate will be a great traitor. We'll talk about that in just a second when we talk about the traitors. We're going to get into that in just a second. But yeah, what was I saying about Porsha? I think that's it. But speaking of the Real Housewives of Atlanta, did we really think that NeNe Leakes was coming back? I just found it interesting that this story came out from TMZ. I don't know who sent this story. I don't know if it was NBC. NBC is very good about their PR. They are very good about their PR. All right? I don't know if it was NBC that sent this news story to TMZ. But TMZ came out this week. And mind you, I'm sure a lot of you are like, we already knew NeNe wasn't coming back. But they were confirming that NeNe was not in talks to return for season 16 of The Real Housewives of Atlanta. I think we already knew that. She's over there with Zeus. Look, she's over there with Zeus, which is fine. If it's paying the bills, NeNe, go ahead with your bad self. Go ahead with your bad self. All right? Just leave us alone. Look, just leave us alone with this whole situation. Just saying. NeNe Leakes is not, she's not coming back at this point. Teresa's door is closed. Yeah, it's closed. It's closed. But at least we can officially say that in any hopes of NeNe coming back, we'll put a kibosh. We'll put a kibosh on that. All right. Speaking of the situation, the PR situation over at NBC Universal, we've got to talk about my girl. You know, if you follow me here on YouTube, I always post beautiful pictures, beautiful gowns of Kelly Rowland. Where's my Kelly Rowland photo? Hold on, y'all. Let me bring up my Kelly Rowland photo because Kelly Rowland has been in the news, but she hasn't said a word. Kelly has not said a word about this situation at all. She has not said a word about the situation. So there was a story that came out while I was in D.C. about Kelly Rowland and her being a diva. Not a diva. A diva behind the scenes. So Kelly Rowland was supposed to co-host the last hour, the late hour of the Today Show with Hoda Kotb. All right? And apparently the dressing room situation over there is not great. All right? If you follow the video that I did, again, I'm just giving you a brief overview here, y'all. The dressing room situation over there is not great. All right? Dressing rooms in general, depending on the venue and things like that, are not always great. All right? Daytime talk shows are probably a little bit better. All right? So the dressing room situation apparently was bad, and they were playing sort of like ring around the dressing room. So Kelly and her team were going from dressing room to dressing room because they didn't like the original one that they put her in. And the one that she wanted, Jennifer Lopez, who was also promoting her new album and the documentary that she did, The Greatest Love Story or something like that. So she said, allegedly, mind you, Kelly has not even said anything about this. Kelly has not spoken out about this at all, at least not at the time of this live show. All right. So allegedly, the dressing room that Kelly wanted, Jennifer Lopez was in. As soon as I saw this story, I said to myself, we have covered, Kelly Rowland is not new to being in Hollywood. She's not new to being famous. You're not going to sit here and tell me that all of a sudden, Kelly Rowland has become some diva and is causing a ruckus behind the scenes. And for this story to even come out says to me that NBC Universal and their PR machine were trying to get ahead of the story. God forbid Kelly may have said something. But Kelly hasn't said a word. Because remember, Kelly, I believe now is also managed by Roc Nation, Jay-Z's company, her best friend's husband. So Kelly has not said a word about this. So I've already been giving Kelly grace with this. Because maybe, look, we can only speculate because we don't know the facts. Maybe Kelly signed up to be a co-host. Maybe she signed up to be that co-host and there were certain stipulations because she's been on the Today Show before, so she knows the green room situation. Maybe she wanted a particular green room because she is a co-host, and maybe they were like, oh no, we got to put you in this room. And she's like, this is not what I signed up for. And she's supposed to be hosting the show. We have heard rumors about Jennifer Lopez over the years of being a diva. So we don't know what exactly happened in this situation. So like I said, I'm giving grace to Kelly for a variety of reasons because we know Kelly has not been a diva before. We've never. And the people that I know that know Kelly Rowland have always said how sweet and beautiful and just nice Kelly Rowland is. Sidebar, Kelly Rowland was recently on the Sherry Shepherd show. So people in the comment section, when they saw a clip of her being on the Sherry Shepherd show, saying, oh, I hope you guys gave her a good dressing room. And, you know, whoever manages Sherry's stuff, maybe it was Sherry herself, saying, oh, we gave her a beautiful dressing room. I don't know what happened there. I don't think we will ever really know because Kelly is not going to come out and say anything. I don't think that Kelly's going to come out and say anything. Sidebar, the family of the Donna Summers estate did say that they would love for Kelly Rowland to play her and sort of maybe like a mini series about Donna Summers' life. Kelly has done interviews in the last couple of years saying that that is a conversation that's happening. We need to make it happen soon, please. But the fact that she's in this new movie, Mea Culpa, a Tyler Perry movie, and I believe she has producer credit on this as well, I think she's working on getting her acting chops together. You know, Kelly has acted before, but, you know, to play Donna Summers, there's going to be a lot of pressure, a lot of conversation about this role. And I want to see it happen, honestly. I want to see it happen. I've been saying that I want to see it happen for Kelly Rowland and the Donna Summers story. But as soon as I heard this Today Show dressing room drama, oh, Kelly Rowland's being a diva. But I also see a lot of what you guys have said. Even if Kelly Rowland was being a, quote, diva, I can appreciate Kelly Rowland knowing her worth, knowing her value, knowing what she's put into this industry, and standing on it. God forbid a black woman asks for what she wants, and then that turns into a big news story. But like I said before, we've never, ever heard of Kelly Rowland being a, quote, diva. We've heard Jennifer Lopez, and I don't know if I even believe all of those stories. But at the end of the day, the Today Show is not owned by Jennifer Lopez. So whoever makes these decisions is above Jennifer Lopez's head. So obviously somebody was out there trying to fish this story, trying to paint a picture of Kelly Rowland that doesn't consist, and it's not consistent with what we know of Kelly Rowland. And look, we don't know Kelly Rowland. We don't know Kelly Rowland. However, we've never heard stuff like this. We've never heard stuff like this about Kelly. Just saying. Anyways, I say all that to say, Bethenny Frankel. So if you watched our Tuesday Takeover last week, I told you I was re-watching Bethenny is Getting Married. And I gave you a couple of things though. I said, I forgot how funny Bethenny was back in the day. But I also told you, if you rewatch some of the things that she says on this show, she's got a thing. I don't even think she realizes this. She's got a thing with black women. And look, if you see some of her history, shout out to my girl Grace Report. She actually done like a deep dive on her TikTok about some of the problematic things that Bethenny has said, especially about black women. And if you watch Bethenny's is Getting Married, then you kind of see a little bit of like these comments that she makes. And you're like, so the fact that she's weighing in right now about the Kelly Rowland situation is just the cherry on top. Take a look at what Bethenny had to say about Kelly Rowland possibly being a diva.
Kelly Rowland walked off the set of the Today Show because the dressing room wasn't up to par. She was co-hosting with Hoda, and it wasn't it. I've co-hosted with Hoda, and I've arrived there, and the makeup area that you touch up in is like, grab a croissant and some plastic and pray for the best. And it's just not what that's about. And it's an honor to be there and to sit down with Hoda. And that was not the moment for diva expectations. It's the area where you touch up your makeup with the drop cloth if the dressing rooms are too crowded. Then there is the area where Hoda and Jenna get their makeup done, and it's a room with a bunch of people coming in and out of it. And finally, you get your own small dressing room where hair, makeup, wardrobe, and all your hopes and dreams need to fit on this very special occasion. So first...
Kelly Rowland walked off the set of the Today Show because the dressing room wasn't up to par. She was co-hosting with Hoda, and it wasn't it. I've co-hosted with Hoda, and I've arrived there, and the makeup area that you touch up in is often a drop cloth, like a black drop cloth. And then your dressing room is the size of a closet, and you're trying to fit all your people.
All right. Let me hold on, y'all. Let me just see this here on TikTok. There we go. So here's the thing, Bethenny. Bethenny telling someone what they should or should not want, especially a black woman, what they should or should not, you know, expect. You don't, first of all, I get it. I'm never going to say Bethenny should not weigh in and share her thoughts, especially because she has worked on the Today Show. But I just find it ironic. The same person that has been slamming NBCU and Bravo and LDTV Reckoning, You did not even give Kelly Rowland enough grace, because Kelly has not spoken out. You're basing your thoughts and opinions off of a Page Six story. And you, of all people that have talked about how they work and how you don't trust them, you've been slamming NBCU for months now. So automatically you believe them? Automatically you believe what's being fished out there to the press? Especially as someone that understands how these PR situations happen? I found it ironic that she was defending NBCU after slamming them out in their treatment of their workers. It's so ironic. Are you trying to work your way back into the good graces of NBC Universal, Bethenny? Is that what you're doing? Or do you not understand your hypocrisy? Because you're slamming them for the way that they have treated reality TV stars. And now all of a sudden you're defending them and saying that you should be grateful. You should be grateful to be on the Today Show. F the Today Show. Not in our Black History Month. Not when it comes to R. Kelly Rowland, who's done her years of service in this business. She's part of the number one selling girl group of all time. She's Beyonce's bestie. She's gorgeous. And she's been nothing but gracious based on what we've heard and seen of her over the years. But I just find it so ironic that you should be grateful. Bethenny, if you don't sit down with your microaggressions towards Black women, it's so plainly obvious at this point. Go watch some of the footage from over the years and the things that she said about Black women. Bethenny, sit this one out. She's deleted this. She's deleted this video. But of course, with the internet, people saved it. But like I said, after that, I was just sort of like, okay. But then I was reminded, I'm like, wait a minute, you were just slamming NBC Universal in their treatment of their workers. And you are basically saying, oh, this Black woman should come and be grateful. You're going to be on the Today Show. Like I said, at the Today Show. What? Shut up. Exactly. Exactly. Miss Esquire says, mistreat white reality stars equals not right. Mistreat a Black woman you invited to co-host equals black woman ungrateful. She doesn't get it. She completely doesn't get it. And this is why I have such a conundrum sometimes with Bethenny. Because like I told you guys last week, I was like, you know what? I forgot she was such great reality television. But I did notice some of the microaggressions that she makes about Black women on that show over the years on Watch What Happens Live. And in other places. And this was just another perfect example of, you've got a problem with Black women. Where's Omarosa? And that's a clip that sticks in my mind when Omarosa was on Bethenny's now canceled daytime talk show. And she says, you know, as a Black woman, we have to work three times as hard as you. You can come show up and be mediocre. Oh, she's never. Bethenny has never gotten over that. Bethenny has never recovered from that read from Omarosa, and she had to pay her $10,000. She had to pay her $10,000. Julie, thank you so much for another super chat. Julie says, I'm confused, as Hoda said on the third hour of the Today Show that she would love to share a dressing room with Kelly. Is NBC spinning it as true? Who knows? Who knows? Who knows? Who knows? Who knows? I mean, to me, the dressing room issue could have been resolved, I'm sure, but maybe they just weren't willing to resolve it. And Rita Ora, girl, you didn't have to chime in regards to the whole situation. You could have just been like, it was a great opportunity, because you also probably didn't know what happened. So confirming that, oh, you had to come on last minute and blah, blah, blah. And like, I'm so grateful to be a part. All of y'all can. Not in our Black History Month. Anyways, Chocolate Soul, thank you so much for the super chat. Chocolate Soul says, per Lonnie Love, they weren't scrambling, as Rita Ora was already scheduled to be a guest. Sit down, Bethenny. So Rita, again, this confirms for me that Rita Ora, you should have stopped. There's a reason, because So I saw a tweet where someone said, my biggest question is, why was Rita Ora just walking, you know, like, you know, just wandering the halls of NBC Universal? But obviously she was there for something. She was there for something. But she probably was not there to host, which is fine. You did fine, Rita. The music career is not hitting, so you got to do something. You got to do something. I like her music, but it's not hitting. Remember when Jay-Z was trying to make Rita Ora or something, and it just never happened? Just saying. Ms. Esquire, thank you so much for the super chat. Ms. Esquire says, whenever people want to humble black women, they hit us with the grateful card. This is an honor card. It's giving that scene from The Morning Show with Nicole Beharie. You know, I am so behind when it comes to The Morning Show. Here's the thing. Yeah, we're going to just continue to follow this story. I doubt Kelly Rowland will even address this, but if she does, Kelly, we with you, girl. That's the shirt. I meant to wear my Kelly shirt today. I forgot. It's all right. That's right. Oh, they coming for you, Rita, in the comment section. So I'll leave you alone. I'll leave you alone. All right. I got my water bottle, y'all. My coldest. If you still want to use our discount code, it's still active. Kempire 10 for 10% off of your anything at coldest. They don't just have water bottles. They have sheets. They have pillows. They have all kinds of stuff over there. Even stuff for your pet. Head on over to coldest.com and use the discount code Kempire 10 for 10% off. Mm-mm. All right. Moving on. I always forget. You know what? I think this is a perfect segue to talk about Kelly Osbourne. Oh, my God. She's insufferable, too. Kelly Osbourne. So Kelly Osbourne is weighing in on people that are using Ozempic, but specifically on the people that are slamming those that are using Ozempic. Our friends over Complex write this. Kelly Osbourne is a fan of the weight loss prescription medication Ozempic, despite her mother, Sharon Osbourne, denouncing it. In a recent conversation with E! Online, the 39-year-old made it clear she thinks Ozempic is amazing. She has never admitted to taking the medication, but did go through gastric sleeve surgery where she lost 85 pounds. She says, the people who hate on it the most are the people who are secretly doing it or piss off that they can't afford it. Unfortunately, right now, it's something that is very expensive, but it eventually won't be because it actually works. She continued, people hate on it because they want to do it. There are a million ways to lose weight. Why not do it through something that isn't as boring as working out? So Osbourne's comments came shortly after her mother, Sharon, revealed her issues with Ozempic during an appearance on the Piers Morgan Uncensored. According to the elder Osbourne, she didn't want to lose as much weight as she did and advised to keep this stuff away from younger people. So as you know, Ozempic is an FDA-approved prescription medication for people with type 2 diabetes, but has become a weight loss trend due to how the drug works with the brain to affect satiety. People have speculated various celebrities have used the drug to lose weight, including Khloe Kardashian, 50 Cent, and oh, damn, I forgot they said 50 Cent. A bunch of people. Look, I think my biggest issue with Ozempic is the fact that people that need it for diabetes are unable to get it. All right? But it also should be noted that not everyone that has had extreme weight loss is using Ozempic. There are other weight loss medications that are being used. With that being said, as soon as I saw this clip of Kelly Osbourne talking about this and talking about how people are jealous because they can't afford it, it was giving me that moment when she was on The View and she was like trying to talk to Donald Trump. And she says, if all the Mexicans leave the country, who's going to clean your toilets? And I was just like, it feels like she thinks that she's really saying something and it doesn't land. It comes across elitist, ignorant, racist. And I'm just like, girl, go somewhere, please. Please just go somewhere. So I wanted to mention that. All right. I have so many other hot topics I want to talk about. All right. We're just going to move on from there and talk about Monique. So Monique's son, as you know, we played the video for you. He came out with his response to her Club Shay Shay interview. And I said to you before, I was really surprised that Monique even gave it a response because I didn't feel like his first video really slammed her hard. You know what I mean? I felt like it was just him telling his side of things. But apparently she was triggered by it, and she did a 30-something minute video. Most of it, though, was about everything else. It wasn't just about him. But that's where her husband, Daddy, revealed, alleged, I think he confirms in this next video, that he does have mental illness. But Daddy revealed that, and she just sat by and allowed this man that's not his father and would not allow him to call him Daddy, revealed that he had mental illness as their comeback, as I guess to discredit what he said in the video, which I felt was very poignant and well said. Well, now after they did that video and posted text message exchange between Monique and him, he's now responding on TikTok. So this is what Monique's son had to say.
Here we go again, right?
Hi, I'm Solange. I'm gonna jump right into it. I guess the intelligent thing to do when assuming that your son is having a mental episode is to post personal screenshots of text messages that are 3 years old in an attempt to validate a false narrative as if they are some type of receipt. You also invaded the privacy of my daughter's grandparents by posting your receipts. Neither of you should never speak on mental health again if you thought that that idea was a good one. As a person who lives with mental health issues, let me be the first to educate you that there are individuals who have taken their lives, harmed, and also taken the lives of others for doing the very thing that you so proudly did and your fan base pats you on the back for, which is very telling to how strangers will buy into your toxicity. Picking up the phone to check on your son that you believe is having a mental episode to make sure that he is okay, while also making sure that your granddaughter is safe, is too much to ask, I guess. For those wondering, I have gone to therapy on several different occasions, and that is not something that I will ever be ashamed of. I have even gone to therapy with my mother on several occasions, but for those who know how efficient therapy only works when both people are being open. My mother was still in her 15-year-old mentality phase during that time, so I guess I understand why she did not know how to be open with me during our sessions. When a person becomes accustomed to being a victim and others get used to seeing them as one, they live their lives in a state of internalization, meaning you consistently receive another's approach as an attack, constantly putting you under the illusion that you need to always be on the defense, even in situations where there is no actual attack, just an acknowledgement of things already said by you. One should not feel attacked by an acknowledgement of the words that they stand on. You eventually become a passive aggressor. To address the men that had something to say in regards to men don't do what I'm doing, let me be very clear. How I man is none of your business.
Period. That for me was a bar, because a lot of people, he's responding not just to his mom, but he's also, Shalon is also responding to what people have been saying on social media. And someone just in our comment section said, I don't believe that Monique even watched Shalon's original video. She was more responding to the backlash. She was responding to what people in her comment section were accusing her of being a bad mom. Shalon continues.
What and how I feed my family has no place on your plate. For every person that stated I should not have come to the internet, I would just like to ask, what do Club Shay Shay, the articles about my mother and I's relationship, the interviews about our relationship, and Instagram all have in common? Well, if you are competent, the internet. Furthermore, I did not expose my mother, nor did I badmouth my mother. I simply provided context to what was already being said about me, while also explaining why I don't speak to them directly. The reason those that feel negatively about what I said are just having a hard time differentiating between Nikki Parker and Monique. Please stop with the cornball idea that a celebrity can talk about a family member on the internet for years, but God forbid said family member says any one thing, and you all are outside with tiki torches and pitchforks, defending not the actual person, but the idea of a person. These people are in an industry that is efficient at making money off of what is pretend. So in essence, you are defending a character. I love my mother, and it took the birth of my daughter to help me begin to understand the value of a mother. I am very proud of my mother, though. And I'm proud of the things that she has accomplished and will go on to accomplish in the future. My mother's bad, man. I watched that woman go from Baltimore to the moon. That drive is also in my daughter's blood. Not only is she still my mother, she's also a part of history. And I will be doing my daughter a disservice by not telling her about who my mother is and was. But since those messages that you posted were used as some type of a receipt to validate your false narrative, I figured I would take some time to gather up my receipts to validate my decision to move forward with my life without my mother in it. I do want to thank you all for listening for the now final time that I will ever address this topic, and I will leave you with my receipts.
So his receipts were just pictures of him and his daughter and I guess his other side of his family. I didn't want to play it for you guys because he plays some copyrighted music when he plays it, but his receipts weren't what you thought they would be. His receipts, Shalon's receipts, were receipts about him being a father and his daughter. So again, someone taking the high road, someone being mature. I did see the video of Monique talking about her son during one of her recent tour stops with Cat Williams. So I want to end it. I also saw an article where DL says he is not trying to reconcile with Monique. I don't think you can reconcile with Monique without taking complete, even if you aren't completely wrong, you would have to be completely wrong in order to be friends with, or even in a good place with Monique. But even so, you see how they constantly bring up Lee Daniels. Well, Lee Daniels, he apologized to me publicly, he apologized to my children, blah, blah, blah. At this point, look, at this point, shout out to Shalon. I think his response was perfectly said. And again, I don't understand why exactly Monique felt the need to respond the way that she did, or as they say, a hit dog gon' holla. So maybe that's part of the reason why she did respond the way that she did. I didn't think that his first video needed that response. Catrice, thank you so much for the super chat. Catrice says, I can't name not one Rita Ora song. I do like Rita. Rita Ora has a couple of songs that I like. I can't name them at the moment. But proving Catrice's statement to be right, but there is a song or two that I like. I can't think of the name now. Out of Order, thank you so much for the super chat. Out of Order says, I'm in love. Wait. I'm in love. Kelly is the ish and the, and not the, oh Lord. All right. Out of Order. That's why your name is Out of Order. Miss Esquire, thank you so much for the super chat. Miss Esquire says, there's a really bad pattern of black children of black celebrities speaking the truth and there being this messy social commentary. That's on T.I., Kirk Franklin, 50 Cent, Brian McKnight. It's a lot. So thank you so much, Miss Esquire, for the super chat. We appreciate your support. So I wanted to briefly give you an update in regards to the whole Monique and her son situation. Look, I just want Monique, just, you know, tell your jokes. Look, tell your jokes. Leave your son out of it. He's not a public person. He wanted to speak his truth. I don't think that he said anything wrong. I don't think he said anything wrong, but maybe you did. I can't tell you how to feel about what he said about you. All right. All right, let's get back into our reality TV talk. So for those that are just joining us, this is our Tuesday Takeover where we cover a variety of pop culture and pop culture news. We've got a lot of stuff to cover and we got to talk about Love is Blind Season 6. So Love is Blind Season 6 is now available. The first six episodes is now available on Netflix. And I'm just going to give you a brief overview of my thoughts and opinions about this cast. Okay, Matt scared the hell out of me. What was Matt doing? As soon as he walked in, his demeanor with some of the women, where if he wasn't feeling them, he walked right on out. I was just like, what is going on with this man? But then he connected with two women. But just when I thought he was really connecting with AD, he was saying the same thing to the other woman who ended up leaving. And AD was not trying to have it because she's like, you fooled me. As if he didn't realize that these women would go back to their quarters and talk about the stuff. Anyways. Ivy says, Kemp, did you see that what Mo said about her son in a stand-up? Like, yeah, I briefly just mentioned that. I just said I'm not going to get into Mo's response because I feel like it was uncalled for. But Love is Blind, Season 6. First of all, Jessica from Love is Blind season 6. Here's the thing. So, you know, there was sort of this love triangle between Jessica, Jimmy, and Chelsea. And a lot of people on social media are responding because Chelsea said that she looks like Megan Fox. In all fairness, Megan Fox doesn't look like the original Megan Fox. There's that. But does she look like Megan Fox? No. But she also was in her own love triangle. And again, if you're going to miss out on spoiler, if you don't like spoilers, you know, don't pay attention to this. Then, you know, swipe out and come back. But she had her own little love triangle, Chelsea, because she had to choose between Jimmy and, oh, damn, I forgot his name already. You guys remind me. Look, this is also learning a bunch of new names for us this season. I started watching this while I was in D.C. Oh, K-Baby says, I'm convinced that Matt was casted to be a villain this season. I don't know what he was casted as, but he was very concerning. He was very concerning, Matt. And I actually was kind of happy for them. And look, I don't love Clay for AD. This interaction between Clay and AD, when they first see each other, I was creeped out. There was something about Clay's energy. I mean, AD, she's quirky in her own way. But Clay, oh, Trevor, thank you guys. I couldn't remember Trevor's name. Trevor's the guy with the mullet. All right. Thank you guys. Let me add that because you know we're going to continue to talk about this situation. Hold on. There we go. Let me just add his name here. Trevor. Okay, there we go. But can y'all go back? Clay and AD's interaction for me. The way that he was acting, the way he... Because remember, he wanted to hear more about how she looked from the very time that he met her. And she was immediately turned off by that. Part of the reason why she leaned more towards Matt, but then Matt turned out to be terrible and deranged. So I think she sort of settled for Clay. I think she did. But seeing them interact, I was like, this is weird. Like, he was acting like, for lack of a better word, an F-boy. Just the way that he was carrying himself around her. And he's like, oh, so what do you think how I look? Blah, blah, blah. And he was like, oh, I like what I'm seeing. Blah, blah. And I'm thinking, like, they both were acting strange. Like, she stepped out and she was showing her body and stuff like that. I don't see this relationship lasting. I have not watched episode 6. So I'm only talking about what's happened since episode 1 to episode 5. All right? But this interaction, I can't pinpoint what it was. And they're a good-looking couple, but their energy just felt off. I do believe that they're attracted to each other, but maybe it felt like it was just very superficial. It was a very superficial thing. I didn't like Clay's energy either. I didn't like his energy. Something about him gave off, I don't want to say narcissist, something though. Something was off for me when it comes to Clay and AD's first meeting. All right? Honestly, I don't know how you guys feel about the other couples. I really don't even care about the other couples. Jessica's reaction to Jimmy basically saying that he's chosen someone else. Mind you, he had a conversation with Jessica, but right before he told Chelsea that he loved her. And Jessica seemed like she was all cool about it and then immediately went dark very quickly with Jessica. It went very dark with her and their interaction. So they were literally in the middle of a fight when he went to meet with Chelsea and told Chelsea that he loved her. But Chelsea is having this sort of love affair with Trevor. Honestly, I think she chose wrong. I think the reason why Jimmy decided not to go with Jessica was because of the baby. Because she has a daughter. And I think that's the only reason he decided not to choose Jessica. Anyone else? I mean, in all honesty, though, Jessica looks more like Megan Fox. Or a better version of Megan Fox. Than Chelsea. But when Jimmy sees Chelsea, he says, oh, you're attractive. Not that that's important, but you're definitely good looking. Exactly. Someone just said what I just said. Jessica looks more like Megan Fox than Chelsea. A mess. But I will say this, and this is why it's important to note that it's not just about looks, at least not for me. And I don't understand why anyone, Clay, would come on a show called Love is Blind. And even if you never watched the show, the whole premise of the show is that love is blind. You're doing this without the superficiality of knowing how someone looks. I don't understand. But of course, certain people might not even understand that about themselves. Like, oh, I could do Love is Blind. I could do Love is Blind. Whoa, you know, I'm not hooked up on looks. And you get to know someone, you fall in love with someone. But here's the thing. I just feel like someone like Clay, why would you do the show with the premise of the show? I don't get it. I don't get it. But I also don't get why people react the way that they do when someone tells you, oh, I also have feelings for someone else. I get it. It makes you feel like, oh, you know, how could you have feelings for someone else when we have these conversations? And see, well, that's the whole process. That's the whole experiment. Some of them handle that better than others. Jessica, I feel like, did not handle that very well, which she showed her true colors. It's those moments where you start to see how someone really is. That's how that moment really kind of was like, oh, this is who Jessica really is. And based off personalities, I understood why he went more with Chelsea than Jessica. I think Jessica would challenge him too much. And I also think that when she admitted that she had a kid, he was done right after that. You know what I mean? I think after she told him that she had a kid, he was done. And that Chelsea had more points for him. But wait till he sees Jessica. He might be regretting it. He might be regretting it. Jessica, don't go back to him. Don't go back to him. You could do a lot better than Jimmy. Again, I have not watched episode 6. The new episodes will be available tomorrow on Netflix. But I am on episode 5, which I watched episode 5, and they've left the pods, and now we have those couples. I don't remember all the couples. I don't really care about all the other couples. Laura, oh my goodness. Laura tried to have Jessica go home because she found out that Jimmy told Chelsea that he loved her, and she's like, I'm trying to save you. I was sort of like, Laura, shut up. If you're not going to tell her what you found out, shut up. Mind your business. I get it. Her intention was to save her friend from embarrassment. But you just never know what happens between that moment and whether he decides to break up with someone or not break up with someone. He could easily change his mind. Chelsea could have chosen Trevor. I just felt like Laura was being too much in that moment. Anyone else? Cozy Cottage Day says episode 6 is so good. Oh, I really tried to watch everything, guys, before Tuesday Takeover, but we already cover Below Deck, 90 Day Fiancé, 90 Day The Single Life. I really should have just prioritized Love is Blind and said we'll talk about 90 Day Fiancé another time, but I didn't think about that until this very moment. Okay? Foxy says, Laura, hush it. Yeah. So I didn't like that moment with Laura, so I already kind of look at Laura with the side of it. Laura got her man, Jeremy. She's got her man. We'll see how that plays out. This is what Johnny and what's her name? I can't remember. I don't even care about their storyline, to be honest. But they might end up lasting. They might end up lasting. Good for them. But it will be interesting to see. I don't remember if Trevor and Jessica ever spoke in the pods. I'm sure they did, but maybe they didn't show it. Maybe they didn't show it. But let me tell you something. Something about this damn Clay. And even AD. Something's off about AD too. But maybe that... I also think when we talk about Love is Blind, I think when people decide, oh, I don't want to be with you anymore, and they don't get engaged, I think some of that, of their reaction, is the rejection. But I also think some of that is that some of these folks want to be on reality television. They want to get to the wedding. They want to be, you know, they want to be the next Lauren and Cameron. Some of that, I don't think they realize that, but I think some of that is in the back of their minds in regards to that. Oh, I got a little string hanging down from my hat. Oh, I think some of that is what's playing a part. They might not admit that to you, and they might not even realize that for themselves. They might not even realize that for themselves, that's what they want. But so the couples have chosen who they've chosen. I forgot to get a picture of the other couple, the black guy with the braids and the white lady. that they're with. Again, not that interesting yet. They might get interesting later on, but they seem to have a very easy figuring out, this is my person. Crystal says AD loves attention. I'm getting that vibe. I'm getting that vibe from her. Do we think any of the couples will make it by the end of Love is Blind season 6? Maybe Jimmy and Chelsea. Maybe, but again, I haven't watched episode 6. So maybe Jimmy and Chelsea will make it. I think Chelsea chose wrong, though. I think Chelsea had a more of a connection with Trevor. But again, we are watching it from a different perspective. We have to remember, we're seeing the folks. You know, we're seeing their body language. We're seeing how they're talking in the pods. We see how they're talking with their friends. But I just don't see any of these couples really making it. I definitely don't see AD and Clay making it. I feel like she chose him as a second choice. And she, her first inclination where he demanded to know what she looked like was him showing who he really is. And even his body language during this first interaction, I was like, something is off. Something is off about him. And I just don't know what it is. I just don't know what it is. JJ Jersey Girl, thank you so much for the super chat. Rita Ora has a Escada commercial that is cute. Rita Ora is paid. Please understand, she has whatever she's done with her money and investments, she is paid. I don't know how she's done it, but despite having a very lackluster music career, Rita Ora has had, she's good money-wise, all right? TP, thank you so much for the super chat. We appreciate your support. Guys, don't forget you can support the channel also just by liking the video. If you're listening to the audio version of our podcast, Kempire, on Apple Podcasts or on Spotify, don't forget to give us a 5-star rating. We will be uploading this podcast to, live to the podcast. Square Biz, thank you so much for the super chat. Square Biz says, Simon has fled to Dubai. Not fled, come on. They go to Dubai often. They go to Dubai often, I will say that. He cannot return. His GC is revoked. What happens to his properties? I doubt what Porsha knew about his immigration issues. We're going to follow this situation, but he's been back and forth to Costa Rica, to Dubai, since being married to Porsha. All right. Simon did respond on social media in his own way. I guess he wanted to make it seem like he was unbothered by the news in regards to his situation. Lamara, thank you so much for the super chat. Lamara says, Clay seems immature. AD seems insecure and willing to put up with a lot to, quote, be loved. Clay seems ready to put someone through it for his personal growth. That's a good perspective. There's something off. There's something off. I think they are also a little, you know, I think they also probably trying to be the next, you know, Cameron and Lauren of this franchise. All right. Ateka says the British artists are great with their investments. Apparently, because I've always heard that she's done very well for herself in regards to her money. Good for Rita Ora. All right. I can't wait for the reunion, y'all. I can't wait for the reunion because that's going to be really interesting to see. All right. Ms. Esquire says there's no way they didn't talk about his immigration status, especially because he literally applied or made some sort of filing a month after they got married. Shay, thank you so much for the super chat. Shay says, Kempire, in episode 6, the jealousy with the women towards AD's physique is a bit pathetic and gag worthy. Ugh. The guy with the twist fiance is Kenny and Brittany. Sweet. Oh, I couldn't remember. Kenny and Brittany. Sweet. Chelsea is so whiny. Oh, God. So a lot plays out in episode 6. We haven't talked about it, but like I said, I might be inspired to do a special podcast episode. Another reason why you should be subscribed to the podcast. Thank you, Shay, so much for the super chat. We appreciate your support. Guys, if you're just joining us, this is our Tuesday Takeover where we cover a variety of pop culture news and, of course, some reality television. We were just talking briefly about Love is Blind season 6. The first 6 episodes are now available on Netflix. New episodes will be available tomorrow on the streaming platform. All right. Yes, Shay says that Rita Ora has invested well, but she's also married to the movie director, Taika Waititi. I apologize if I mispronounced that. All right. Goddess says that they fetishize 80s body. I did hear that when she was showing off her body, there were comments from the other women. So that's in episode 6. I haven't watched it yet of Love is Blind, but I'm sure I'll have more thoughts next week. All right. Or a special episode. All right. So we still have some more stories that we have to get into that I want to briefly talk about, like this one. So Tiffany Redd is a songwriter and she's slamming people like Seven Streeter, Zendaya. I like to call Zendaya. I like it. Make it fancy. Zendaya and some others in regards to publishing. So I want to briefly play this clip of her basically explaining, you know, a lot of the accusations that Monique had about the industry. She's sort of giving us the other side of it in the music industry.
Almost every record that I have done, I have written when the artist was not in the room. I'll go through my own songs. Replay. Zendaya got 10% of the publishing, I think. She did not write on the song. She didn't. That song was written at a Rihanna song camp. It was on hold for Rihanna. Then it was on hold for Rita Ora. Famous came to me and said, yo, Tiff, there's this artist named Zendaya. We should cut Replay on her. So Zendaya got published in writer credit. She did not write on Replay. King by Tamar Braxton. I wrote and produced that song. I wrote that song for myself as an artist. In my living room, Tamar got, I don't know what she ended up getting. I think I own like 85% of that song. But I should own all of it because I did all of it. She didn't write shit. Seven Streeter, who's a songwriter? This one really hurt my heart. Seven Streeter, just being honest. Me and Mansoor did that song. It was originally called Bitch. I wrote that. None of the artists that I've mentioned have a career anything close to in music, Beyonce. None of them do. But the reason why I'm bringing up my experience with every artist or almost every artist that I've worked with that has taken publishing that they did not earn on the songs that I wrote for them is because there's a precedent that's set. The reason why I called out Beyonce is because Beyonce is the Michael Jackson of our generation. And so if there's anybody that could reshape the precedent, if there's anybody that could influence the industry that had the power and the money and the cultural like thing to say, you know what, y'all, you're right, these songwriters have been out here, we've been in the street, literally. I have been in the street in front of Spotify, I've been in front of Universal, I have sat and I have talked to all y'all publishers. I talked to the DSPs.
So I did want to mention that is Cassie's friend, because Tiffany came out during the whole Cassie and Diddy situation and confirmed some of what she saw with Diddy. So now she's talking about what's happening in regards to the music world. And for those that aren't familiar, it is a very complicated world, and it's only gotten worse because there isn't a lot of money being made in the music industry. And she's made a lot of points, but the reason why I bring it here is because I saw that some people were, you know, they did not see her side of it in regards to it. It's, you know, a lot of people said, well, didn't you sign off on your splits correctly? Why did you give away? Look, it's not that simple. She did go on to talk more about Beyonce and, you know, in regards to how much publishing Beyonce does in regards to, you know, how much credit she gets in regards to publishing of things that maybe she did or did not write. That stems back to even the Destiny Child's day. If you go look at some of the credits where the members of Destiny Child are credited as songwriters, people have said that they didn't write anything. That's just something that Matthew decided to work in so that they would have publishing rights later on, that they would get a percentage of what was on those songs, even though they may or may have not allegedly written anything for those songs. And this all stems back because, look, when we talk about Beyonce entering into the world of country music, and we talk about, a lot of people don't realize that country music started with black people, that black people created country music, that people don't know that a lot of that, the music business and stealing of songs and stealing of publishing and rights for songs started back then. But for only for us to be doing it as a people as well. But this wouldn't be the first time that Beyonce has been accused of doing stuff like that. It should be noted that Tiffany has not written for Beyonce, but she's, you know, of course, she works in the industry and she knows from other people that have worked with Beyonce. And this is part of the reason why she says that she would not work with Beyonce because she does not want to give up a percentage of her work, especially if they are not a part of that process. Especially because they're not a part of the process. Well, speaking of giving up, this is a perfect segue from talking about Beyonce, talking about the music industry, to talking about Jay-Z and Beyonce. Well, more so Jay-Z. You know Damon Dash. Damon Dash started Roc-A-Fella Records with Jay-Z and some other folks, okay? Now there's a report coming out because Damon lost a major lawsuit. His portion of Roc-A-Fella Records, a court has ordered for that portion to be auctioned off, despite Jay-Z and others trying to avoid that from happening. So, according to Radar Online, they write this. They said, embattled music exec Damon Dash was ordered to sell his shares of Roc-A-Fella Records despite objections from co-owner Jay-Z, Radar Online has learned. The New York judge issued the damning verdict after Dash allegedly refused to pay $823,000 judgment to movie producer Josh Weber, who successfully sued him for defamation and copyright infringement following a dispute over the 2016 film Dear Frank. Beyonce's husband, along with co-owner Kareem Biggs Burke, objected to the auction, claiming the company's bylaws mandate that the board of directors must first approve the sell-off. Okay. They continue. They said that, but in a 15-page decision, U.S. Magistrate Robert W. Leiberger shut down the claim and ruled Dash's one-third ownership of the Roc-A-Fella is personal property that can be seized to satisfy a judgment. Oof. They write this. They said, the question at the core of the instant dispute is whether the RAF bylaws, the Roc-A-Fella bylaws, prohibition on transfer and sale of Dash's one-third ownership interest in shares of Roc-A-Fella without the consent of Roc-A-Fella's board of directors legally prevents sale of Dash's interest in Roc-A-Fella to satisfy the judgment. This is what the U.S. magistrate wrote in his decision. The answer, indisputably, is no. Without jurisdiction to enforce a judgment entered by a federal court, the judicial power would be incomplete and entirely inadequate to the purposes for which it was conferred by the Constitution. The legal scrum erupted between 2016 and 2019 when Weber and his Muddy Water Pictures fired Dash as the film's director because he was allegedly unfit for the job. Damn. Dash, who claimed Weber hijacked the footage, allegedly claimed it was his feature film and began shopping the crime thriller to outlets like BET under a new title, The List. Weber successfully sued Dash in federal court but was unable to collect on a 2022 judgment. Jay-Z and Burke, co-owners of Roc-A-Fella, entered the fray when Weber tried to confiscate Dash's stake in the record company, whose artists include Kanye West and Jadakiss, among other chart-topping rappers. Wow. So, the U.S. magistrate blasted Jay-Z and Burke because the duo adopted the no sell-off clause in 2021 during a board meeting that Dash did not attend or vote for. He ordered Roc-A-Fella to deliver Dash's stock certificate to the U.S. Marshals Service for auction in 180 days. So that does that mean that we could possibly does that mean that we could possibly own a little bit of Roc-A-Fella? Who's gonna go? You know, Jay-Z and them are going to show up and buy that out. But just a moment. So to address the concerns over the intellectual property rights of the record company, the U.S. magistrate says they can participate in the auction and place the winning bid to prevent an outsider from purchasing Roc-A-Fella. Damn. This U.S. magistrate was not playing with Jay-Z. He's like, I don't care who you are. So as Radar Online reported, Dash, who's 52 years old, is also engaged in another court battle with his ex-wife, Rachel Roy, in a desperate bid to get his child support payments reduced to $438 a month from $3,000 a month, citing financial hardships and low annual income. Damn, Dame. Shouldn't the royalties from being co-owner of Roc-A-Fella pay a lot, though? I find that to be interesting. Okay. But our resident attorney, Mrs. Esquire, says, this sounds appealable. Ownership is property, but if the bylaws say otherwise, weight has to be given to that under law. But, Ms. Esquire, did you hear the part where the U.S. magistrate said that Damon Dash wasn't there when those bylaws was created, and he also didn't vote for them? Does that play a part? Just asking for legal terms. Look, just asking. Vigilian says he can't pay $400. No, he's saying that that's what he wants it lowered from $3,000 in regards to the Rachel Roy of the situation. He wants it lowered from $3,000 a month to $438 a month because he doesn't make enough. Damon Dash. Damn, that's sad. You know, he and Jay-Z came up together. They created Roc-A-Fella Records. It was huge. And I didn't even realize that he still had ownership in the company. I didn't even realize that. Damn. Well, it is what it is. Look, it is what it is. All right. So can we talk about Traitors? And then I'm getting out of here. Guys, if you're just joining us, this is our Tuesday Takeover. We will be posting the timestamp so you can skip around or you can listen all the way through because I feel like it's everything that you enjoy listening to or watching. Anyways. All right, the Traitors. So I've watched the Traitors multiple times these last couple of weeks. We even did a little bit of a Traitors marathon Super Bowl Sunday last week. All right. So the Traitors this week. I have two stories. Okay, I have two stories. Before we get into the Traitors, for the timestamps, before we get into the Traitors, I want to talk about Larsa and Larkus, okay? Because I was right. I was right. You know how I know I was right? Because now Larkus is being slammed by their own co-stars on The Real Housewives of Miami. So you probably don't know this. Marisol and Alexia have a podcast presented by Two T's in a Pod. Did y'all know that? It's called I Por Favor. I didn't know they had a podcast. I didn't realize it was presented by Two T's, but whatever. Okay. So on their podcast, they talk about this recent breakup and now back together. And I want to play a little bit of a clip. All right. Buckle up. Get a snack. All right.
Well, next topic, my friend. This is an interesting one. I know you and I have a lot of thoughts about the Larsa and Marcus split, or not split, or mummy, or what?
Or what? Or marketing stunt, or I don't know. We don't know at this point.
Okay, so I'm going to read this.
And by the way, the only reason why we're even talking about this is because everyone else is, because she wants people to talk about her and Marcus.
Well, no,
because
no, no, no.
If not, this could have been done very
privately.
Privately.
Well, now she's made it very public, so...
Well, she made it very public as of Sunday when everyone was watching the Super Bowl and, you know, people that know of them and know her and follow, you know, she decided to do that on her social media.
Well, and then, you know, we've been involved in it because we're friends and we've worried about her and we've reached out to her. And so now we're all involved. And I think that, you know.
Well, I don't think she likes people to be involved or to have an opinion.
Mm-hmm.
So well, you may be getting a phone call, my friend.
I don't care. I might not answer.
Okay. I
That's
mean,
how
I don't care either. I just feel like we need to talk about it because I guess she wants everybody to talk about it because that's how I feel. Like it's all over the place. So when you make your life so public like that, because they could have easily had a fight or broken up and no one would have found out. The only reason why anybody
Of
found out that
course.
minute is because she announced it. So because of that, we can talk as well.
Absolutely. So let me jump into this. So Lars and Marcus split after more than a year of dating. The pair, who were confirmed to be dating in early 2023, have gone their separate ways, source confirms to People magazine. Let's
But
just
who are
fast
these
forward this.
sources
I
confirmed to
don't
People magazine? Like, are you kidding me? Yeah.
I'm guessing it was her. This is what I'm guessing, because as things have developed, okay, so fast forward, they each deleted all the photos of each other on their Instagram pages and
Right.
unfollowed each other.
Right. Cuando
And
eso pasa a mi amiga is because something really like bad that pissed you off did that. Because there's no way if you guys are just going your separate ways because you want your working on yourselves and you're doing personal growth. There's no way, spontaneously on a Sunday at 8 o'clock at night, you tell the entire world that you guys broke up and follow each other and take a survey whether you should follow your boyfriend or not or unfollow them. So
And by
again,
the way, I read that, and because I'm a loyal friend and out of girl code, I unfollowed him.
boa.
And
Well, I never followed him because I'm a girl and her friend. I don't follow anybody's guys that I'm not like friendly with. And yes, I'm friends with
clearly.
Marcus, but I don't follow any.
But
I don't
he
follow
was.
none of the guys. I don't follow none of the house
Well,
husbands.
I think that there's a respect there, of course, like you. And he was following me, and I said to her, "Should I follow him back?" And she said, "Yes." So I
Oh,
did.
you asked her for permission?
Of course I did. Of course, because I'm that kind of a
Oh,
person.
now with Larsa, you gotta have to ask her for permission. Yeah.
No, like I don't even have your husband's phone number, and I would never even ask for it. Like, I'm not that person.
I have Boo Bear's number.
I know you do. I just don't camp good with it.
No, in case of
Anyway.
an emergency, I'll call Boo Bear, 911, so they don't
So
have to have Boo Bear's number. But anyways, yeah.
here's
She
the
says
part.
that it has nothing to do with her family input, but it's solely for their personal growth. Do you believe that?
She said that it was for their
Yeah.
personal growth.
Yes, absolutely.
So why did he post a picture with his father when he erased all of her photos? Like he
That
was
was
like,
his personal growth.
that
Yeah.
because that I'm something that my dad and I have had to come to Jesus, like he's, Don
But
Carleone.
do you think his family, do you think the Jordan family has had an input on this whole relationship that has weighed in
Well,
and has?
at first I did, but now that other things have come to light, I'm starting to feel like we've all been scammed, and my mind is going a
Ooh,
million.
so Lars is a scammer too? Are you repeating? What was
I
the
am
reason?
feeling like this whole little scenario has been some
He's a
sort of a
scam.
scam. Because here's one thing that I know, because I had a PR firm and I was a publicist. Jesus, I've
Remember?
dropped that a lot today. That happened a long time. I know about press and paparazzi very well. And I
Yeah.
know where they hang out.
Of
I know
course.
they hang out all over the
How did they
beaches.
know they
I
were getting
know.
back together on Valentine's Day? How did the paparazzi know to get a picture
Well,
of them, right?
okay,
Because obvious.
let me finish my point. I know where they hang. We all know they hang out at Carbone and Prime 112 and behind the hotels on the
They
beach.
don't hang out in Tria Flowers.
No, trust me, they're not hanging out outside of floor shops. It is not a location that is heavily trafficked by celebrities. And by the way, who even goes to a flower shop anymore? Don't you just go get flowers?
Of course.
I mean,
Absolutely.
yeah,
It
so
was
I
so
was,
staged. It was so
yes.
staged
I mean, I
because,
know
first of all,
this
nobody
because
even
I did this for
cares.
a living, and I'm like, wait
Right.
a minute. So now all of a sudden, you're in a flower shop together, but how does a photographer know? Because they don't
And
hang
how do you
out.
walk into, right?
They
No,
don't.
that's
That's
what I'm
not a
saying.
money maker hanging out by a flower shop. Trust me, I know the spots in this town. We
Yeah,
all
no, but
do.
everybody knows it's
You know, in
staged. It was.
LA, it's
And
Cribs, it's
this is why we're
Mastro's.
even talking about it because it's
Right.
so ridiculous at this point
Well,
that.
now I'm pissed because I was upset for her. You and I spent a lot of time talking about it, feeling
Yeah,
bad
we
for
were like,
her.
because,
We
no
were
matter
worried about
what,
her.
Yeah, even though everyone was rooting against them, I was not rooting against them.
No.
I loved them, you know, I loved them together. I loved to see her happy and in love and him as well. So when I first saw that, I said, wow, like, oh my God, can you imagine how Larsa must be feeling? I felt terrible for her. And I reached out, even though I know she wasn't very happy with me because of the
The
reunion.
reunion,
I have to tune in. But you know, even so, I know how to put my differences aside. And when I know that somebody can be in pain or is hurting, I'm gonna reach out to them. So I did. She responded later on at night, thanks, with an XO. But then 2 days later, she gets back with Marcus, and it's all over the place again. And the
But
only
were they
reason why
ever
we
really
don't.
apart? Because this is ridiculous. You don't delete all those photos, and then 2 days later, you call a paparazzi and you're hanging out. I feel like it was just a publicity stunt, and
So
that's what
you think the
pisses me
whole re
off.
but do you think the whole relationship is a publicity stunt and they're both in it?
I have to tell you, if it's crossed my mind now that this happened. Now that I'm looking at the whole thing and the timing and everything, I'm like, and I was a publicist, I'm like, this
Well,
smells
I think it was
like a
very
scam.
calculated. The fact that she dropped that bomb, first of all, you're not that relevant. Okay, everybody's watching the Super Bowl, but of course, I follow her, so do you. And you know, in the
You
housewife
told
world,
me.
right? In the housewife world, well, because I had people texting me, is this true? So, and I figured you would know because I had my phone down. So you reached out to her and she said it was. So
No, she said it
exactly.
was true, the breakup.
Of course, exactly. So, because I didn't, I was like into my game. So, I didn't do any of that. But I saw so many people reaching out to me and asking me. And I said, I think if she would do something like that, I don't think that could be, you know, I think that that's true. I mean, I would never lie about something like that. I just don't know why she's doing so publicly. And, you know, she wanted to call like more attention. First of all, like, you know, you're not that famous. And you know, it's not like you're dating Michael Jordan that people would really care, but she did do that. And then 2 or 3 days later, she's back with him, which I don't care. I want her happiness. So if that's what makes her happy, but now
Me too.
it's
But
like, I'm looking for.
why don't you tell your friends, hey, things are fine now, we're okay? Because we were all really worried. I was like, I'm gonna come see you. I unfollowed Marcus. I went into like girlfriend mode. And now, when I see the flower, the paparazzi photos, I was like, oh my God, are she playing all of us? That upsets me. Because
Well, it seems
I
like we
was.
are all thinking that, yeah. I mean, I just think it's very calculated. I think everything she does is very calculated. I mean, the fact that she waited, I don't know when the fight was, I don't know what prompted it, I don't know, I don't have any details, but the
I
fact that
don't
she
think there was
waited
a
till
fight.
Sunday at 7 or 8 o'clock when the Super Bowl was on to announce that and put it in her story, and then all the other bloggers for the in the housewife world pick it up and this, that, and the other. And then she has like TMZ on speed dial because everything she does, she reports it to TMZ and TMZ picks it up.
One of them had to have told at least one outlet that they had deleted all their photos and unfollowed each other because people were watching the Super Bowl and nobody's paying attention to that.
Of course, that's what I'm saying. Like, nobody cares. But the fact that she thinks that people care and then she calls all the outlets and everybody picks it up and then it starts becoming about that. I mean, I think that's pretty, like, I think that's pretty sick. I mean, like, who like thinks about all those things? I'm
I
just
mean,
like in shock.
if I had put this whole plan together and it was a PR stunt, I would have at least waited a month or 3 weeks before I get back and take pictures with my guy. They
Well,
didn't even
but
wait 2 days.
obviously she doesn't have a PR person because I don't know what PR person and publicist can be telling her to handle her personal life like this. Because it's different when we're filming. The cameras are not here now. So why are you doing this? You know what I mean? If you get into a fight and you're filming, you're going to film in your apartment that day and Marcus is not there, instead of lying, say the truth, whatever it might be. But the fact that we're not filming right now and she still wants to make her relationship so public and her life so public is shocking to me.
Who told you first? Who told you first? And I completely forgot, not completely, but the fact that Marisol, who does have a PR background, who does, you know, play these games in media, and she's had to play these games as a publicist, is calling out the fake and phony relationship. I think because when you're in it and that's your friend, you're going to believe your friend. You're not looking at it from my perspective or our perspective when watching this relationship. You're also not hearing things from multiple sources that I don't believe that this is a real relationship. And when someone told me that, over a year ago when this first started, when it first became public, I was like, oh, that's interesting. So I just kept on watching because I don't just go by what, you know, what a source might DM me. And I said, let me just. And then the more I watched their relationship, Larkus's relationship, I was like, yeah, it's giving fake and phony. And the fact that the first scene that we had last season with her with that weird date that she had, I was like, why would she do this? Like, it feels so pre-produced, this relationship. And then all of a sudden, we see her, this relationship with Marcus. Marcus, who is a Nepo baby, doesn't have anything else going on for him. And now people know who he is besides, oh, Michael Jordan's son. And even then, people didn't really know who he was. So the fact that Marisol and Alexia are both saying that, oh, it's giving fake and phony. We already know season 7 is in the bag. Yeah, season 7. I can't wait. I can't wait for the reunion because apparently something comes out about Marcus at this reunion as well. I guess we'll have to wait and see what that is. I'm excited. I'm excited for the season finale of The Real Housewives of Miami. I'm excited for the Real Housewives of Miami reunion. And I'm excited for season 7 of The Real Housewives of Miami. But since we're talking about Larkus, we have to talk about the show that they were on, The Traitors. Yes, let's talk about The Traitors. And then I'm getting out of here. So you know I love me some of The Traitors. I literally have watched probably this last episode of The Traitors three times I've watched this episode because it was that good. All right. So spoiler alert. So Trishelle, as you already know, a couple of weeks ago when Dan left, had already suspected Phaedra. She was like, I think Dan was feeding us a traitor. So since then, she's been taking notes in her notepad and she feels like Phaedra's a traitor. So she tells Peter, we need to get Phaedra out before we get out poverty. But this move makes everyone look at Peter differently. Like, why all of a sudden we were all on the same page? It was all about poverty leaving, and now it's about Phaedra. So now everyone is looking at Peter with a side eye, but everyone still agreed that they felt that poverty was the traitor. All right, before we get to that, this week's challenge was them being locked into a cabin with bugs, all kinds of odors, and them trying to get out. We even get a Big Brother legend be a part of this. I haven't watched this guy's season. Now I want to go watch it. But I can't. I have too many things that I'm watching right now. I can't. But Trishelle is on to them. Look, Trishelle is on to Phaedra, and I hate that for us. I need to protect Phaedra at all costs this season. But now the heat is on her and Trishelle is still there. Peter is still there. But I think now they're turning their energy on Peter because they're like, Peter, what are you doing? Because he's already separated the faithfuls, which has made him look suspicious. But now that they voted out poverty tried her best to put the heat on Phaedra. She turned on Phaedra and she's like, I will work with you, Peter. I don't know if she really believed that Peter believed that now that she was a faithful. I don't know if she really believed that. But they vote out poverty. Poverty's gone. But it was close. It was a very, well, not close. It wasn't a close vote, but there were quite a few votes for Phaedra. But Phaedra standing up to Trishelle and them saying, you have a little bit of a twitch. Kevin was like, do you know, have you always had this problem with the twitch? You know, because she likes to do, I don't think it's that she has a twitch. She has very long eyelashes, y'all. But Phaedra does not back down, even though she did not expect that she would be on the chopping block this week. But she goes right into fight mode. And again, she won a case. She won a case. Yay. She won a case. Finally, she won a case this week. First, it was up against Dan, and then it was up against Trishelle, Kevin, and in poverty. I really did not. I wasn't sure. I was like, damn, are they really going to go for Phaedra? But Phaedra has also not been playing this game the best either. Yes, her social game is great. However, apparently people have been watching her, and she very much like Dan, doesn't talk a lot of game. and is talking about, you know, Trishel's like, oh, you're twitching, and all this stuff. I don't know. Deborah says Kevin is just stupid. Yeah, Kevin just kind of goes with the wind. Kevin is just beautiful gowns. Kevin, beautiful gowns. But because Poverty is gone, they have to get another traitor. So Phaedrus is like, Kate. So Kay Chastain is asked to come down to the dungeon. So they're doing things a little bit differently. I'm not sure how they're going to ask Kate whether or not she's going to be a traitor, or if they will just tell her, you are now a traitor. She might not have a choice in the matter. But Kay is so funny because she's just not interested. When they're playing that game, when they're trapped in the house, she's like, she looks up and she sees a trap. And she's like, oh, I'm not doing this. I'm not doing this. Someone else do this. I'm not doing it. She is so not about winning this game as a faithful. I don't know if she's even inspired to win it as a traitor. However, she's part of the reason why Phaedra is still there. Because at the round table, she's like, I find it so weird that your entire MO was all about Poverty. But this week, it's about Phaedra. It just doesn't make sense. And when she had a conversation with Peter afterwards, she's like, I'm not saying that Phaedra is not a traitor, but your switch up was weird. I really do like Kate Justine. I like her energy on the show. I told you, next season, I need her to host the reunions. Andy will be hosting this year's reunion. Larkis will be there. So we will probably get a more insight to what may have happened in the relationship. I listened to the rest of the podcast, and Alexia says we will never know the truth on why they broke up. If it's up to Larsa, we will never know the truth about why they broke up. Do we even care? No. I think I already still believe, and this just proved to me, the contract has been extended. This is not a real relationship. Whatever. I'm glad they're not on the current season of The Traitors because I don't know if I could watch them an entire season, to be honest with you. It's bad enough that we had to watch them on Real Housewives of Miami. All right. Jay says Phaedra and CT are basically a house couple, but you saw CT was already sort of like turning on Phaedra. He's already sort of turning on Phaedra. Do you think that Phaedra will last? Do you think that she will actually win the game? I don't know. I think she's going to come close. But I don't know. I mean, she's playing a good social game. She's not great at the competitions because she also ran out of the house during that trap. She's like, something's in my ear. Something's in my ear. Poor MJ also ran out. MJ's walking around the house trying to hear people's conversations. MJ is a mess. Ashley, thank you so much for the super chat. Ashley says, Kempire, yes, you peeped game. Julia did the work, but she was friends with the Kardashians. So are we really surprised? No. You're right. I'm not surprised at all. Joe, thank you so much for the super chat. Joe says, can you imagine if Sheree wins for doing nothing on the show? If she does, she may not be able to invest more. She may be able to invest more into She by Shein and other unpaid bills. She might make it. If the faithfuls make it to the end, then she might be able to win. And because no one saw her as a threat. The same with Kevin. No one sees Kevin as a threat. It is what it is. Guys, we have over 1,100 people here for our Tuesday Takeover, where we cover a variety of pop culture news, reality TV, and reality TV news. Be sure to like the video. Replay crew, be sure to let us know your thoughts on anything that we talked about, including The Traitors, 90 Day Fiancé, Love is Blind Season 6, or your reaction to some of our pop culture stories as well. What is your prediction, live chat, for the rest of The Traitors? We're almost done. I think we only have like two or three more episodes of The Traitors US. I hope they send over the UK season 2 version soon, because we're going to go through withdrawals without it. Please, look, please. And also, I heard the Australia version. I was listening to another podcast, and they were talking about how season 2 of the UK was really good, but season 2 of the Australian version was even better. So I'm looking forward to watching that. The season 1 of all of The Traitors from the UK and Australia are available on Peacock. They're not paying me, but they should. Okay, they should. All right. HFG says, unfortunately, Phaedra probably won't win because everyone suspicious usually goes out at the final cauldron. Yeah, probably. Probably, unless you really like, maybe we will see something dynamic from Phaedra in the next couple of episodes that will shift people's gears onto someone else. I don't think Peter's playing a great game. He's very smart, don't get me wrong, but now I think he's sort of put a target on his back because of how divisive he's been in regards to the game, you know, when it comes to the faithfuls. Hey, Sophie. Sophie says, loving the Alexia and Marisol are calling out Larkus. Congratulations for calling out Larkus. Your psychology degree gives insightful commentary. Love your podcast. Thank you, Sophie. Appreciate that support and comment. Danny, that's what I heard. Danny says there's a big twist at the end of The Traitors, Australia. We need it over here as soon as possible, please. And thank you, Peacock. I need to watch it. I know they're going to bring it over here. We already have season one of Australia and UK. So season two of Australia and UK are done. So we're just waiting. We're just waiting. Okay. Riz says, did she go off on The Bachelor yet? No. No, she has not gone off on The Bachelor yet. So that is to come. That is to come. This is the way that we should have been introduced to Phaedra. This is the way that we should have been introduced to Phaedra. Not the way that... you know, through Married to Medicine or through Ultimate Girls Trip. No, that wasn't the way. That wasn't the way. If I had to rate this week's episode, I would give it 10s. It was 10s. Wasn't it 10s this week? Yes, yes. Blanche says, they said the Australians be drinking and hooking up. That's what we want. That's what we want. And next season of Traitors USA, I want to mix back in some of the regular folks. And I get it. Reality TV people are regular folks. But no, I like this season, and I think it's a great season. But I like the aspect of introducing people that are really out to win some money for their livelihoods. And I know some of these reality stars are too. But I want some regular folks. For me, at the end of last season, some of the real folks that were really fighting to have, you know, get this money being, you know, betrayed by reality TV stars. It was interesting. It was really interesting to watch. And I was a little disappointed that we didn't get real folks this season. But I do feel like this is a good season regardless. But who do you think will win? Do you think the faithfuls will win? Now that Phaedra's enlisted Kate Chastain to be a traitor, what do you think will happen? It might shift the game. It might shift the game. Well, I'm looking forward to it. We will continue this conversation in the comments section. Thank you to everyone that was here. We were live for, oh my gosh, for over 2 hours, almost 2 hours and 15 minutes. I appreciate everyone watching on TikTok, everyone watching on YouTube. If you're part of the replay crew, be sure to let us know your thoughts on any of the topics that we covered. And if you are in the Philly area or South Jersey area, I'll be coming to Philly City Winery on March 7th. March 7th, tickets are now available. If you live in Boston, we are coming to your town May 30th. And if you live in Atlanta, we'll be coming to Atlanta on July 12th. A lot of you in Atlanta are already getting your tickets. You guys have been waiting. You guys have been waiting. And I appreciate all of the love. Every single show is going to be a little bit different. But if you missed our New York City show and you're not a member of the channel, you can now hear a part of our New York City live show for the Kempire After Dark Tour on the Kempire Podcast exclusively. So be sure to subscribe to the Kempire Podcast. Head on over here. Give us a 5-star rating on Apple Podcasts and on Spotify. Take a listen. Let me know your thoughts. And we can continue this conversation on Twitter. Twitter. All right. Thank you all for being here. I will see you guys later. Bye, y'all. Happy Tuesday. I will see you next for our Vanderpump Rules recap, Real Housewives of Beverly Hills, and so much more. Bye, everyone. Oh, my. You got that hotter than a summertime in July. Time magic. And I got to have. No, I can't leave that boy alone. Need a taste up in the morning. You got a girl just jonesing. Need a fix from my favorite type of candy store. Got me shaking, going out of control. Let me have a little something. You know I'm hooked upon that loving. Let's rock, rock, roller skate. Let the
follow